Thank you for joining me today. I am certified pet professional Amy Lee. Should you cook for your dog? Last week we talked about three most important basic pet care needs: bathing your pet, brushing your pet, and trimming your pet's nails. This week we're diving deep into the most critical element when it comes to the needs of your pets, and that is hands down their diet. Yes. This is a huge topic, one that we will be continuing on for weeks to come. So stay put, my friends. It's about to get real. Let's take a look at the trailer for Pet Fooled. This is a documentary on the pet food industry. This is going to be the basis of our discussion, guys.
First ingredient, ground yellow corn, chicken byproduct meal, corn gluten meal. Although this food really looks to be beautiful and something you'd be interested in nourishing your pet with, my recommendation is to avoid it.
The pet food industry is telling us what to feed our pets, really more based on what they want to sell us than what's necessarily good for the pet. So no corn, no wheat, no soy.
After many years of R&D, we have found that corn is still the best available source of carbohydrates.
What?
Those are the things that cause overweight, diabetes, arthritis, chronic skin infections, allergies. Corn and wheat have become so subsidized and so cheap. It's a super cheap way to make a food for somebody who can't say no.
More than 60 million packages were taken off store shelves last month because they apparently contained wheat gluten that was tainted with the chemical melamine.
They thought they were purchasing a certain protein product called wheat gluten, when in fact they were buying wheat flour that had been laced with cyanuric acid and melamine.
Sounds
in order
yummy.
To pass it off as wheat gluten.
That was a betrayal of trust.
They don't care about me. They care about my money.
You have well-meaning, lovely veterinarians recommending foods not because they have sound nutritional background, but because that's all that they know. And in 100 years' time, we have successfully convinced an entire generation of pet lovers that why would you feed anything but dog food or cat food?
For years, we have been fooled into believing that the pet food industry had our backs. And most importantly, we believed that the pet food industry wanted what we want, the best for our pets. The last decade has proven to be anything but that when it comes to the pet food industry as a whole. We have learned that our pets have been poisoned, deathly sickened, and compromised as a species by our own hands. Because we trust our pet food industry, as well as we trust pet professionals who recommend these unfit pet food manufacturers. Because of this lost trust, pet owners are interested in making their own food for their beloved pets. Although many veterinarians will discourage this, and for good reasons, we will talk about that. If you're going to be solely feeding your pet home-cooked dog food, it has to be done right. It has to be well-balanced, or it could definitely be detrimental to your pet's health. Your pet needs a biologically appropriate, excellent quality, species appropriate diet. The foods we feed our dogs and cats need to be in the biologically correct form, meaning a moisture-rich, not dehydrated protein source. Diet is the foundation of health. This goes for us too, guys. We know this. When pertaining to diet for our pets, there are two very critical factors that we need to deal with. One is that foods have the ability to heal, and the second one is that foods have the ability to harm. Now, here's something else I want you to know. Depending on what you're feeding your pets, food has the ability to do both. Let's remember that as we move forward in this discussion today. I'm going to be specifically quoting Dr. Karen Becker in a lot of my topics and a lot of the information that I'm giving you today. Right now, I would like us to take a look at Dr. Becker explaining to us how we should be reading the labels for the pet food that we buy for our pets in stores. Whether that's high quality food, boutique food, whether it's low quality, whatever. We're gonna start with this. This is gonna be a great place to start. Let's check it out.
Now, a couple of different things you need to think about. Pet food manufacturers know that you want to see meat first on the label. Meat meaning you want to flip it over and you want to see chicken. And as long as people see chicken, they think that they have you snowed. Chicken or beef written first on the label actually is raw meat, which is wonderful. The downside is that meat in its natural state is about 70% water, which means once the meat's been dehydrated, which is what has to happen to put it into dog and cat foods, The volume of the second, third, and fourth, and fifth ingredient actually make up the bulk of the pet food. So if you see chicken first on your pet label, followed by brown rice, white rice, corn, and barley, those four ingredients that come second, third, fourth, and fifth on the label actually ultimately make up the majority of the pet food. And the first ingredient, the meat that you so wanted so much to see on the label, actually could be less than 20% of what's actually in the dog food bag. So meat first on the label is excellent as long as it's followed second by meat and third by meat. If it's first a meat and then second, third, and fourth a grain, then you're being snowed into thinking you're feeding a primarily meat-based food when really you're feeding a primarily grain-based food. So you have to learn how to read labels, not only the first, second, third, fourth ingredient, but you have to be able to read the labels in the context of, is it a meal, which means it's already dehydrated meat, or is it raw meat? And raw meat's great, but once the moisture is taken out of the meat, then it weighs less, and everything on a dog and cat food label is listed by weight. So the heaviest item is first on the list, followed by the lighter items. So in the bag of grocery store brand kibble that I have to show you, the ingredient label is, first ingredient label is chicken, followed by organic barley. Now, they will try and snow you with the organic part of things. A lot of people think that if they're feeding organic brown rice and organic barley and organic millet, then it must be fabulous for their pets. And we're really thankful that you're thinking about getting the chemicals out of your pet's diet. But organic grains are much better suited for a vegetarian animal. So I'm not a big fan of you sacrificing species appropriateness for organic carbohydrates. If you have a bunny or a horse or a cow or another vegetarian animal, think about feeding them organic grains. If you have a healthy dog or cat, don't think about feeding organic grains because it's just not biologically necessary. In this particular food, the second ingredient is organic barley, followed up by organic oats, organic peas, and then organic chicken meal, sorghum, organic soybean meal, and so there's a lot of carbohydrate in this food. The downside about this particular food is that although it's organic carbohydrates, it constitutes about 80% of the diet, which is too many carbohydrates for a healthy dog or cat.
So now that we know that dogs and cats were designed to eat a high moisture diet, we have to realize that pets that survive strictly on a dry kibble diet, they significantly lack the desired food moisture level that they need. And this causes them to live in a chronic state of mild dehydration. That can ultimately cause organ stress and just lead to many other health problems. Many. So before we go any further, guys, let's take a look at what dogs and cats need in a diet, what that should consist of. High moisture, protein, moderate fat, low carbohydrate. However, the majority of the pet foods on the market today consist of the exact opposite. Low moisture, low to moderate, poor quality protein and fat, and they're high in starch and carbohydrates. When we think about what we should be feeding our pets, our goal is to mimic the ancestry diet of dogs and cats as closely as we can afford to do. Unfortunately, our goal should be to feed our pets an unprocessed diet, exactly what they would eat in the wild. Feed your pets as much unprocessed foods as possible, guys. Some healthy food is better than no healthy food at all, and research supports that theory. Even if we only commit to using fresh food for snacks, we are still providing excellent options for our dogs and cats. Just offering one meal a week as fresh food would be a great place to start in the journey to feed your pet fresh food instead of processed. It doesn't have to be all or nothing. Simply work towards providing the best food you can afford to feed. But keep in mind, you should not mix processed food with raw, fresh food as one meal. Animals can process both types of food. However, they cannot digest them the same. They process raw, fresh food differently than they process dehydrated processed food. A nutritionally balanced raw, homemade diet is by far the best choice for your pets, hands down. However, there are other options. Here's some reasons we may consider to cook for our pets at home instead of rely on the pet food industry to take care of the needs of our pets. Cooking for your pet at home gives you complete control over what goes into their mouth. A homemade diet is species appropriate, designed to meet the needs of a specific species and their metabolic and digestive needs. We have become quite educated on the specific nutrition needs of dogs and cats, meaning that we understand that it is imperative that we do not feed our carnivores carbohydrates such as grain, corn, wheat, rice, soy. Dogs and cats do not have a grain requirement need in their diet. However, most pet foods contain grains as fillers because they're cheap. They're cheap fillers. They could be added to the dog food, avoiding adequate quantities of nutritious ingredients, which may be more expensive, but they're claiming that their product contains those nutritious ingredients. Another reason why people decide to cook for their pets at home is because consumers find it hard to find good quality, human-grade, grain-free pet food. If you do find them, they are very expensive and the pet owners really can't afford to purchase them on a regular basis. So they're choosing to make the food for their dogs at home, which is actually a great alternative, but it's one that comes with a huge commitment. Creating your own home-cooked dog food is actually cheaper than buying human-grade quality canned food. Not to mention that the food that you cook for your pets at home is free of preservatives and just flat out wholesome for your pets. A major benefit to home cooking for your pet is that it allows you to avoid certain chemicals, preservatives, artificial colors, flavors, and emulsifiers from your pet's diet. That's a big plus. Even great quality pet foods add flavor enhancers, emulsifiers, and extra fats that are quite enticing to the pet's palate, but they provide no nutritional value to your pet's diet. One downside to cooking for your pet at home is depriving them of the complete balanced diet that meets all the vitamin nutritional needs required, and not depriving them of vital components that they depend on to maintain a healthy existence. This can result in life-threatening metabolic deficiencies, so the foods have to be balanced. Choosing to completely change your pet's diet is something that will take a lot of thought, research, commitment, and education. And I recommend reading Dr. Becker's book. I've gotten it for myself. We are going to talk a lot about this. I would like it if you guys might want to pick up this book if you're interested in really getting in tune with your pet's diet. Her book is called Real Food for Healthy Dogs and Cats. It's linked in the description of this video below. You can purchase it on Amazon. I consider reading this book before making this life-changing decision for your pet. If you are considering changing your pet's diet, I am considering it for my dog, Gus. Let's watch this clip by Dr. Becker about her book. See what she has to say. About
preparing a homemade diet is that if you follow a recipe, which is what we're going to recommend you do, you're going to know in your heart that you're meeting your pet's vibrant living food requirement, but also feeding them a species appropriate diet in terms of it being nutrient balanced, omega fatty acid rich, and vitamin mineral supplementation in correct proportion. So I have prepared a diet with my pet lifestyle coach and pet nutritionist, Beth Taylor. We've written a book, Real Food for Healthy Dogs and Cats. And the great thing about this particular recipe book is that it's not only AFCO compliant, but it's NRC and ancestral diet compliant, which means it meets the nutritional requirements for all of those organizations for a biologically appropriate, healthy diet for all stages of a pet's life. So whether you have a kitten or a dog, there are recipes included in this book that will be able to meet your pet's needs. The other great thing about this particular recipe book is that if you are a novice and if the thought of preparing foods for your pets is intimidating, these are easy to follow, balanced recipes that you'll be able to prepare. There's lots of nutritional variety, and it teaches you how to prepare the food and store it so you're able to do it efficiently. There's also a chapter in this book on how to pick healthy treats for your pets, because we know treats are important. There's also a chapter on how to incorporate commercially available raw food diets and how to pick the appropriate raw food diets that would be commercially available to incorporate with a homemade feeding schedule if you so desire. One last tidbit that many people ask, they're interested in preparing a balanced, species appropriate diet, but they're not necessarily ready for the raw. And there are recipes in this book that will help you make a cooked diet. In addition to making the diet, we show you how to create
the essential vitamin mineral mix from vitamins and minerals that you can purchase from your own health food store, blend together an appropriate quantity, and then supply it to each batch of diet in the appropriate amounts for your pet's body weight to be able to make the diet nutritionally complete according to all of the standardized organizations suggesting baseline nutritional requirements.
Guys, I've linked several videos on Dr. Becker's YouTube site that I would like you to watch after we're done with our discussion here today. All of the videos down there, please watch them one by one. I think I'm going to link about three today. As you get spare time this week, please watch those videos. And that's just going to fuel our discussion for next week, because we're going to pick up on this topic again next week. And we're going to talk more about preparing those foods for your pets at home. You can do it, and you probably should.